Hello and welcome to the Magic of Mathematics channel. My name is Manohar Murthy and you are watching one amongst a series of videos exploring the world of mathematics. In this video, I intend to give you an intuitive understanding of the prime factorization method for finding out the least common multiple or LCM of a set of numbers. I will assume here that you are familiar with the concepts of factors, prime factorization, multiples, common multiples, and LCM. I'll be using a couple of examples for explaining how and why the prime factorization method works. Let us begin by considering a very simple example. Let us assume that we have been asked to find out the LCM of 2, 3, and 4. For doing this, let us use the definition of LCM, namely that it is the least amongst all the common non-zero multiples of the three numbers. I would like to mention here that although we will not be using the prime factorization method in this simple example, I intend to use what we learned from this simple example to build an understanding of the prime factorization method. Let us begin by writing down the first few non-zero multiples of these three numbers. For the number 2, the first few non-zero multiples are 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, and so on. For the number 3, the first few non-zero multiples are 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, and so on. And for the number 4, the first few non-zero multiples are 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24, 28, and so on. From our listing of the first few non-zero multiples of 2, 3, and 4, we can see that 12 and 24 are common non-zero multiples of the three numbers. And 12 being the first non-zero common multiple we encounter, it is obvious that it is the least amongst all the non-zero common multiples, and hence the least common multiple or LCM of these three numbers equals 12. So far, we have seen how to find the LCM of a set of numbers just by using the definition of LCM. Using this as a base, we are now ready to understand the prime factorization method for finding the LCM of a set of numbers. I'll be using a more complex example for building this understanding. Let us assume that we need to find the LCM of three numbers, namely 1680, 1350 and 392. Let us express these numbers as a product of their prime factors as shown. Let us consider the first number, namely 1680. From what we have seen from our simple example, we know that any common non-zero multiple of the three numbers should definitely be a multiple of 1680. Let us consider the first non-zero multiple of 1680, namely the number 1680 itself. Since any common multiple of our three numbers has to be a multiple of 1680, we will use this as the starting point or base for constructing the LCM of our three numbers. To make our life easy, let us replace the first non-zero multiple of 1680 with the product of its prime factors as shown. We will be constructing our LCM using this product as a starting point. Let us now turn our attention to the second number, namely 1350. Let us consider a non-zero multiple of 1350, namely 2 times 1350. Let us now prime factorize this multiple of 1350 as shown. We can easily observe that this multiple of 1350, and for that matter any non-zero multiple of 1350, should contain the prime factors of 1350 as its factors. Now that we have observed this fact, let us erase the prime factorization of 2 times 1350 and let us turn our attention back to the prime factorization of the first non-zero multiple of 1680. Let us examine this product to see if it can result in a multiple of 1350. For that, we will need to verify whether all the prime factors of 1350 are contained in the prime factorization that we have shown here. Let us do that now. We can see that we need at least 1, 2 in any non-zero multiple of 1350. We have 4 2's here, so we are fine with respect to 2's. We need at least 3 3's in any non-zero multiple of 1350, but we have only 1 3 here. Similarly, we can observe that we don't have the required number of 5's as well for this product to result in a non-zero multiple of 1350. It is clear that if we add 2 3's and 1 5, the product will evaluate to a non-zero multiple of both 1680 as well as 1350, since it would contain all the prime factors of both these numbers. In other words, the product that we have shown here would evaluate to a common non-zero multiple of 1680 and 1350. However, the question remains whether this product evaluates to the lowest common multiple of 1680 and 1350. It is clear that the only ways we can get a number lower than what this product evaluates to is by dropping one of the numbers in the product or by replacing one of the numbers with a lower number. Let us try out both of these and see what happens. Let us drop 1, 2 as shown. We know that any multiple of 1680 should contain at least 4 2's in its prime factorization. After dropping 1, 2 from our product, we have only 3 2's left. So our product will no longer evaluate to a multiple of 1680. Similarly, dropping one or more occurrences of other factors would result in the product not evaluating to a multiple of 1680 or 1350 or both. So we can see that dropping a factor clearly doesn't result in a lower common multiple than what our product evaluates to. Let us now see if replacing one of the prime factors with a lower number would help. Let us go back to our original product first. Let us now replace the 7 with a 6. It is clear that the product would now evaluate to a lower number than what we had discovered previously. But the question is whether the product evaluates to a common multiple of 1680 and 1350. For answering this question, let us replace 6 with its prime factors as shown. When we do this, we have increased the number of 2's and the number of 3's contained in the product, but we have taken away the 7 required for our product to evaluate to a multiple of 1680. So, even replacing one of the factors with a lower number is ruled out. Let us revert back to our original product again. It is clear that what we have here is a product that evaluates to a number which happens to be the lowest amongst all the non-zero common multiples of 1680 and 1350, and hence is the LCM of 1680 and 1350. We now turn our attention to the third number, namely 392. Following the same logic that we have used so far, if we add the required number of 2's and 7's to our product to make it a multiple of 392 as well, we would get the LCM of 1680, 1350 and 392. It turns out that our product contains sufficient number of 2s and we need to add only one more 7. The product now evaluates to 529200, which is the LCM of the three numbers. Let us look at the product one more time to see what it is constituted of. We have 4 2s, which is the number of 2s contained in the prime factorization of 1680. We have 3 3s, which is the number of 3s contained in the prime factorization of 1350. We have 2 5s, which is the number of 5s contained in the prime factorization of 1350. And we have 2 7s, which is the number of 7s contained in the prime factorization of 392. Hence, it is clear that the LCM of a set of numbers can be obtained by prime factorizing each number first and then picking up all the occurrences of a prime factor from the prime factorization where it occurs the most. In our example, the prime factorization of 1680 contains the most number of 2s, namely 4. Similarly, the prime factorization of 1350 contains the maximum number of 3s and 5s, namely 3 and 2 respectively. And the prime factorization of 392 contains the maximum number of 7s, namely 2. So, the LCM of the three numbers can be found by evaluating the product of 4 2s, 3 3s, 2 5s and 2 7s. This concludes our study of the prime factorization method for evaluating the LCM of a set of numbers. I hope you found this video useful. Thanks for watching.